Aloha, everybody. Kaiwaza with you. Welcome back to the Cheap Lounge. It is, believe it or not, the season finale of season two. We are up to episode 25 of season two. That's our final episode of the season. Next one will begin season three, if you can believe it. And we have many more seasons coming, I'm sure. Anyway, what is the Cheap Lounge? This is where we will be showing and discussing and hearing little samples from cheap lounge records, inexpensive dollar bin thrift store records that I have uploaded recently to my hobby online radio station called Moody Mood Music. And you can listen to that anytime. That'll be linked down below. If you enjoy this kind of music, I encourage you to check it out. So season finale, let's get started with the records I have to show you today. The first one up, technically it's classical. I mean, it's really a classical album, but it's by guitarist Laurindo Almeida, performing not one guitar, but playing two guitars. Not at the same time, of course, they are dubbed. But these are arrangements of classical pieces using two guitars. And I think the majority or all, maybe, of these classical compositions were not written for a guitar. So whatever, adaptations. A little bit about Laurindo Almeida. Was a Brazilian born guitarist and a composer as well. Born in 1917 in Brazil and passed away in 1995 in the States. Actually had a long career in both classical and in classical Latin and jazz music fields. In fact, he and Bud Schenk are partially credited for the creation of the craze known as the bossa nova, which we love, the bossa nova here at Moody Mood Music. And over a span of 50 years, he recorded more than 100 records, so quite an active career. He started, actually, at 19 years of age, working on a cruise ship that used to cross the Atlantic from South America to Europe. And he wrote a song called Johnny Peddler, which actually was picked up and became a hit by the Andrews sisters. And so he took the money from that hit and moved to Los Angeles for his music career in 1947. And he went to work right away with several Hollywood film studio orchestras. His first work in the jazz field was with the well-known Stan Kenton in the 1940s, and his solo career began in his classical solo career began in 1954 with an album called The Guitar Music of Spain. Now this is from 1972, this album. This is well into his recording career. Bach is Beautiful, all Bach compositions. And he, along with his wife, I believe, it's mentioned on here, did all of the arrangements for these pieces. And again, if you don't, this is one of those things, if you don't, you may not recognize the titles of the songs, but as soon as you hear them, you're like, oh yeah, yeah, I know that piece. During his career, he won 5 Grammy Awards, quite a few. He was actually teaching and recording and performing until the week before his death in 1995. He died at 77 years of age of leukemia at his home in LA, but was performing, recording everything up until the week of his death. Okay, next up, the lovely voice of Miss Polly Bergen. My Heart Sings is this album on Columbia Records. It comes from 1959 and it was reissued in 1996. This is the 1959 one here. Lovely cover. Is it fair to say that she was maybe well known, better known as an actress than a singer? I mean, I think she was well known in both, but maybe an actress, some people might know her better as. She was born in 1940, died in 2014. Actress, singer, TV host, also an entrepreneur, and she did write a couple books, I think. Born in Knoxville, Tennessee. Her father, interestingly, was a construction engineer who did have some singing talent, although he never did it professionally. And when she had a television program going for a while, she actually had her father on the show a few times. And they did record an album together, an album of duets called Polly and Her Pop. At one point, but that was just that one record. She had many, many film roles, including being the romantic interest in several of the Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis comedy films. She was in several westerns, and she actually won a Grammy Award for playing the lead in the Helen Morgan story, playing Helen Morgan, obviously. In 1950, she was also kind of known as the Pepsi-Cola girl because she did like a slew of ads for Pepsi-Cola during that time. She was also a regular panelist. You might remember her from being a regular panelist on To Tell the Truth. She was on What's My Line a few times as well. Lovely voice. This particular album has an address. I love when if they could tell their stories, these records. Formerly the property of Joseph C. Johnson Jr. of Madrid Street in San Francisco, California. Joseph, if you're out there, we have your record.
I'm in the mood for love, simply because you're near me. It was one of those nights. Just one of those fabulous flights, a trip to the moon on gossamer wings.
But this record is interesting in that it's half-half. The side one is all, it's more upbeat, and then the second half is more of torch songs. I love them both. She does a great job with both. Love her voice, but you know me, I'm kind of a fan of torch songs. So I do like both, but yeah, I really like her singing those slow, sad songs, you know, Polly Bergen. She also eventually owned a line of cosmetics called Oil of the Turtle. and as I said, did lots of TV appearances, quite a bit of acting in some TV films, about a dozen record albums. Didn't have any top 40 hits though, but had quite a good career. She passed away of natural causes in 2014 in Southbury, Connecticut. She had developed emphysema in the 1990s, but she didn't pass away until 2014. Anyway, that is Miss Polly Bergen.
The weather is cooling off, and it won't be long now before it will be time for you to enjoy a night by the warm fireside. Perhaps with me. And what would be the perfect accompaniment for this warm hearth? The intimate, lovely, lush sounds of moody mood music on live365.com. Mr. Kaiwaza is spinning vintage vinyl records of lovely orchestras and wonderful singers, both soloists and wonderful groups. It will warm your heart to hear these old melodies again by the warmth of the fireside. Perhaps you'll join me here. All you have to do is click on the link below in the description, and it will take you directly to Moody Mood Music. But be careful with your heart, darling. Burn, baby, burn.
Up next, kind of an unusual album. This is an organist. Again, very well known in the classical field rather than like, you know, pop music. E. Power Biggs. I had to get this when I saw it just because I thought, okay, this is very unusual. The album is all Scott Joplin rags, okay? I'm not going to talk a lot about Scott Joplin. I'm not going to talk at all about Scott Joplin, except in a future video, I'm sure we will. But he just wrote, African-American songwriter who wrote a whole bunch of rags, like a lot. Many of them. The Entertainer, probably being the best well-known one, you know. But he wrote a bunch. But not only is this album by E. Power Biggs all Scott Joplin, it's not performed on the piano, as they normally are. It's performed on the pedal harpsichord. And it's volume 2. So there's a volume 1 out there, but this is E. Power Biggs, Scott Joplin, on the pedal harpsichord, which I thought, I'm just very intrigued to hear that. I don't believe I've ever heard Scott Joplin rags on a harpsichord. Now, E. Power Biggs was a British, well-known name, a British-born organist who became an American citizen, born in 1906, died in 1977. He was brought up on the Isle of Wight in the UK and moved to the US in his 20s. He was classically trained at the Royal Academy of Music, emigrated in 1930, took a post at Christ Church in Massachusetts, and he held that post for the rest of his life. Credited for helping to, one of the artists credited for helping to bring the classical organ to prominence again. It had sort of had its glory days quite a ways back and was not so much in being recorded or whatever, but if you are into classical music and you look up organ records or whatever, you'll see there's a lot of E. Power Biggs. That's usually what he's doing, is playing the organ. And interestingly, E. Power Biggs was a person who was very public in stating that he felt music should be performed on instruments representative of the time that it was written in. Which I think is sort of interesting then that he did this album. I don't know if he had a change of opinion lately, because I don't think the pedal harpsichord is really current with Scott Joplin, or with something like Scott Joplin rags would have been played on in the time they were written. Correct me if I'm wrong, I could certainly be wrong, but I don't think harpsichord was was not a real happening instrument in the 1920s. And one of his rival organists, a well-known Virgil Fox, would argue with E. Power Biggs and say that his position was going to be relegating the organ to becoming like an antique museum piece, if that was, you're only going to use it for something during the time it was written for. He did host a weekly radio program, E-Power Bigs, on CBS Network from 1942 to 1958, recorded extensively, about 45 record albums that I could see. Passed away at 70 years of age. And I, as I said, this is volume two. So there's volume one out there I gotta keep an eye out for. To me, I enjoyed this. It was interesting. I'm not necessarily a fan of Rags, but I did enjoy it. And I would look forward to hearing more things on the harpsichord. I always pick up records when I see them and they're played on the harpsichord. I do like harpsichord, and it's kind of interesting to hear things that wouldn't normally be done on. I like just classical harpsichord music, I do, but then also things that wouldn't have been written for a harpsichord, to hear them played on it, I sort of like. Now here's a group, I'm not going to talk a lot about them. I think we talked about them previously, I'm not 100% sure, but the Four Freshmen and Five Guitars, it's a great record. What do you say about the Four Freshmen? I guess all I would say about them is I love them. They're a vocal quartet, originally from Indiana. If you like the modern airs, the Pied Pipers, the Meltones, very similar kind of style, very tight harmonies, jazzy influence there. Yeah, they started in 1948 recording. They were from Indiana. They went through the mid-50s, really, recording. And interestingly, this group is still around. They still are not recording, but they're still performing, although not the original members. There was quite a bit of shifting around of members of the Four Freshmen, even during the time that they were doing these records in the 50s. So it was not a completely stable membership, but the sound is very stable. Check it out. I like it.
And to while away a dreamy afternoon, a lovely, peaceful afternoon, no one can see us. Rain, it's so cozy in the rain, by yourself, sure.
So my question, this is the Four Freshmen and Five Guitars. Now they recorded many albums, but they did several, they didn't call it a series, but it was kind of a series. They did several of this. There's Four Freshmen and Five Trombones, Four Freshmen and Five Saxophones, Four Freshmen and Five Trumpets, and then Four Freshmen and Five Guitars. Now this was being recorded during the whole percussion craze as well. So I'm kind of curious why they didn't do anything like that. Like, why didn't they do, you know, the Four Freshmen and Five Bongos? I mean, it would have been right up their alley, I think. Or, you know, the Four Freshmen and the Five Xylophones. That'd be interesting. You know. I don't know. Why didn't they do that? I don't know. Finally, we have an artist that I personally love so much. He was called the Velvet Fog, had a beautiful, beautiful velvet voice for sure. We're talking about Mel Torme here. This is one of his, not one of his early records, this is sort of a mid-career kind of album, really, or later career, from 1969. Mel Torme, Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head on Capitol Records. This is definitely from the era when a lot of pop stars of the past were trying to be cool and hip and were recording pop songs, redoing pop songs of the like 60s and 70s, some with more success than others. Now, what's interesting here for me is that Mel Torme really is one of the few people that could take those songs, and because of his background in jazz, his background in arranging also, he could really take these songs, which are like Take a Letter, Maria, Traces, Sunshine, Superman, Spinning Wheel, You Made Me So Very Happy, and really put a cool spin on them. Really enjoyable and good, just still like not only kind of amusing or funny that, you know, they make you chuckle, whatever, but actually good too. So I enjoy this record. I have a couple of records from this time in his career that I really, really enjoy. I have a lot of CDs of his earlier jazz stuff. His amazing voice.
Sunshine came softly through my window today. Could have tripped out easy, but I changed my ways. It'll take time.
Something
you got me feeling so high. I wanna take off and fly, cause with that look in your eye, you brought the sunshine into my life. Talk about love.
Born in Chicago in 1925. Died in 1999. Like I said, it's called The Velvet Fog. His nickname. Singer, composer, arranger. You will know, or if you didn't know, you know now, that he co-wrote the Christmas song, you know, Chestnuts Roasting on an Open Fire. He wrote the music and he co-wrote the lyrics for that. So we have that chestnut to thank, Mel Torme to thank for that one. Started singing literally at the age of 4 in a hotel as a paid performer, if you can believe it, at the age of 4 in a Chicago restaurant, I should say. Wrote his first song at age 13. When he was 16, one of the songs he had written called Lament to Love became a hit with Harry James Orchestra. So he actually composed a hit record at the age of 16. And then his own, you know, career, singing career took off. In 1947, interestingly, he was in a musical called Good News, and it made him for a while a teen idol. I didn't really know that. And I don't know, I just have trouble looking at this face and thinking this was ever a teen idol. You know, love Mel Torme, but I can't, maybe I have to look at some pictures. I can't say at any point what I consider that really a good-looking person to be a teen idol, but I don't know. He formed a vocal group called the Meltones that was sort of based similar to Frank Sinatra and the Pied Pipers concept, and similar to the Four Freshmen, which we just saw, kind of a sound. And interestingly, one of the original members of the Meltones was Les Baxter, who all of us would come to know later on for his exotica music, orchestra conducting, and composing. In the 1950s, Mel Torme had a radio program called Mel Torme Time. And then in the 60s and 70s, he started to do records like this, where he was really taking like Beatles songs and whatnot and kind of redoing them in a contemporary style, in his own style, right? He did have a career-ending stroke in 1996. He survived. He just, that ended his, he did not perform after that. Then he passed away 3 years later in 1999 of a stroke, and he was 73 years old. That's Mr. Mel Torme. We love him. Love Mel Torme. Okay. That's it. That's a wrap. That is the end of season 2 of The Cheap Lounge. I hope you've enjoyed that. If you did, please give a thumbs up and subscribe if you want to see more. Don't forget, you can check out Moody Mood Music. That's going to be linked below. Also, have a Buy Me a Coffee account if you feel like you want to send me a little donation to get a cappuccino or something. That would be lovely. No pressure or anything, but that would be nice. So you can do that. That's linked below also. So season 3 coming up, I guess I'll say, yeah, any suggestions, up to you. I mean, I don't know if you like the way we like, there's a production team, me and my videographers and the staff here at the Casa de Tiki Java. No. Yeah. Anyway, any suggestions, things you'd like to see different? things you don't like about what I'm doing, or suggestions or whatever, we will take them into consideration. Just let me know below or send me a message or something. Anyway, have a good one. We'll talk to you later. And I was going to say happy Halloween, but I'm sure I'll see you before Halloween. It's a week away. So anyway, more than a week away, I think. Yeah. No, less than a week away. I'm getting very confused about time.